I like what you said about Spencer. He is so broken. I can fix it for him. Because you said something about him being really self-sufficient when you first met him, but you also saw something in him that made you think that you could help him, that you can save him from himself. I don't know how many women do that. I know so many women that's done that. And I did that with Jim. I remember thinking, oh, by the time I'm done with him, he's gonna be so ready to make the next wife of his happy and everything. This was before I even considered him to be like a boyfriend or dating or a husband. I just knew that we could be friends and I had so much I could offer him and teach him about women. If there is a God, he was laughing at me that day. Ho ho ho, let's make Crystal teach him. That's funny. I really like what you mentioned about the happiness levels, and I totally followed along with your visual. I think that's kind of sad how low Spence is all the time. You also mentioned sleeping on the couch, and I completely identify with you on that. I tried sleeping on the couch several times. I successfully did it a few times, but it's so uncomfortable that I always ended up going to bed more than 90% of the time. And it was my codependency that kept drawing me back to bed, not just because it was uncomfortable, but because I just wasn't as mad anymore and I wasn't as self-righteous or whatever I thought. I felt like, I mean, I need to make this right because he's just going to be more pissed in the morning. And so I would always go back to bed. You mentioned go to bed when he, oh my gosh. The go to bed when he goes to bed thing. Oh, I felt obligated for years. I still feel obligated. Like he'll come to me when I'm up on my computer at 11:30 and he's like, I'm going to bed now. And I'm like, okay, bye. Like, I don't know what he's expecting of me. He knows I'm not going to bed with him. Is he wanting me to go to my bed also? Like, is he telling me it's my bedtime? I don't even care anymore. I just stay up. But my old programming is reminding me, I think he wants you to go to bed. You should probably go to bed so he don't get mad. And I'm like, shut up, brain, shut up. He didn't tell me that, and I'm not gonna listen to you. Like that's like old programming up in there, and I still don't go to bed when he goes to bed. But it was 14 and a half years of me going to bed every single time he wanted to go to bed. Every single time. I never dared make my own decision to stay up later. And when I tried to, I got in trouble for it. That's the emotional abuse piece part. So it was codependency to prevent emotional abuse. Codependency to prevent emotional abuse. Codependency to prevent emotional abuse. And when it wasn't emotional abuse, it was codependency to prevent perceived what could be emotional abuse. Because I was so scared of it, I tried to prevent it. Or hurt feelings or whatever I was trying to prevent. Wow, I'm so awake to it right now. It's amazing. Because I've been really numb and easy to forget about it, but I'm really awake to it now, and I think that's why I've been so down lately, is because I'm not honoring my truth about it. I'm pretending like everything's going better or something like that. I don't know if it's pretending. I don't know what's going on. I'm really confused right now. Going to bed. Okay, hard. Okay, then there's a few things that you mentioned here. Hard time sleeping. Spence has a hard time sleeping. You mentioned that he's a light sleeper, and you mentioned that you felt guilty. Those three are my husband to a T. So even if I just roll over in bed, he wakes up and he's up for an hour or two, can't go to bed till 4 or whatever is going on in his brain. He's such a light sleeper. He has a hard time sleeping. And then I feel guilty because whatever I just rolled over, or I looked at my phone and was trying to play Candy Crush or something, trying to fall asleep. I have had the hardest time being feeling safe in bed to fall asleep. All right. I'm starting to work some stuff out here. When I would go to bed with him, I'd make sure that everything was perfect for him so he could go to sleep. I said what I needed to say. I did what I needed to do. I smiled when I needed to smile. I rubbed his back when he's not feeling so good. Whatever I needed to do that so he could get some sleep. Now, if I needed sleep, if I wasn't tired, if I was, my mind was racing, if I was sad, if I was gloomy, what I was, you know, whatever was going on with me, I had to try to deal with myself in the very best way I could, as long as it didn't interfere him and his sleep cycle. And so if I was stressing or whatever, I would play my Candy Crush, and if that woke him up, then I would deny myself what I needed so that he could get what he needed. That's another great reason why I'm in my own bed. I know he's having a hard time sleeping. I know that's half the reason why he's not working as much as he used to. He's been calling in sick a whole lot lately, ever since I moved into this bedroom. I think he's called in sick at least once, or I'm gonna say 1.5 times a week since I moved into this bedroom, which it's been a month now. Happy anniversary. 1 month anniversary for 1 month anniversary. 1 month anniversary for my finding my independence and coming into this room. It's such a huge deal for me. I'm sorry, I've kind of ramped up, I guess. Hard that. So he's my husband's a light sleeper. I would feel guilty. He'd have a hard time sleeping. And then I'd have a hard time sleeping because now he's having a hard time. So I'd always I in order for me to get to any kind of zen, oh, here's the thing I was working out. In order for me to get to a zen, I'd have to know that he's okay. If he wasn't okay, I couldn't be okay. I couldn't be calm. I was so worried about whatever was coming up next, you know, him not going to work the next day or him blaming his sleep thing on me or whatever. And so being in this room has been really difficult for me to not get up and go to the bedroom to make sure he's okay. I can't be at peace until I know he's at peace. And because I don't know he's at peace, and I'm pretty sure he's not at peace, and I'm like 100% sure that he's stressing and depressed and sad that I'm not in there with him, that's why I've been up late almost every night. That's why I can't seem to calm down. That's why I get on Marco Polo and talk and talk and talk and just try to calm myself down, because I can't calm him down to calm me down. I can't do my codependent thing. It's a practicing the no contact and learning to self-soothe. Yes, I'm using Marco Polo. Yes, I'm talking to you to self-soothe. So it's kind of a dependent thing, but not really, because you're not having to compromise your life to self-soothe me at 1:20 in the morning. So it's not trading one codependency for another unhealthy addiction, right? That's what I'm trying to tell myself anyway. I can kind of see how Marco Polo might be an unhealthy addiction, but it's not, as long as it's not hurting me and it's not hurting you and it's helping me. It can't be unhealthy, right? It's not like I'm so tired, I'm gonna force myself to talk. No, that'd be unhealthy. I'm really not tired. I'm really ramped up. I really need to get this off my chest. So thank you for being there for me to tell me what you think about all this tomorrow if you want, but I'm not expecting you to, or I'm not requiring you to. It's not what I need you to do so that I can go to sleep. That's not, that would be codependent, but I'm not doing that. I'm not expecting you to. You see what I'm saying? See how I'm working this out to try to like get really solid with my own thoughts about this and my own beliefs? Yeah, that's what I believe. I'm good. Okay, move on. Sorry. Okay, then I liked how you mentioned that there was always a bitch session, and you realized later that you were just trying to avoid the bitch session by sleeping on the couch. Okay, I got a couple thoughts going here. My husband doesn't do the bitch session thing at night. If anything, it's me that does that, because it's my time to wind down. It's my time to decompress. It's my time that I want to be heard, or I want to just process some things. And if there's something bothering me, I would try to get it off my chest and try to get the validation and, you know, attention or whatever I needed from Jim to give to me so that I could feel better about all the stuff I was thinking. So I would go through this bitch fest at night to him, and he would fall asleep on me or ignore me or not say anything or get angry with me or tell me he wants to go to bed. Like he would not. So, and sometimes he would support me, and sometimes he would talk to me, or sometimes he would just tell me what I wanted to hear, or it was never something I could really rely on. And it wasn't until I recognized how needy he was that I could finally start seeing how needy he was to me. And that's when I started recognizing the codependency and looking into it and trying to practice not needing him to fix me and all that stuff, right? So I stopped doing the bitch fest. But what I was going to say about Spencer and his bitch fest is much like training a puppy. I don't know if you have dogs. Do you have dogs? I don't think you've talked about dogs. Maybe you have. I just don't remember. Sorry. Brain fart about the dogs thing. But what I was saying is, okay, what a puppy needs before bed, even a cat, right? What an animal needs before bedtime is to have a little bit of a play fight or a playtime or something to get them ramped up so that they're exhausted when it's time for bed. They need that, because if you don't give that to them, then sometime in the middle of the night after they've had their little cat nap or their little short nap, then they're antsy. They want to go out. They want to go outside. They want to play. They want to whine. They want to eat. They want to, you know, go for a walk. They want to play with their chew toy or bark at the lights driving by or whatever. Every time we've had a puppy, if you don't give them that 20, 30 minute, probably not that long, if you don't give them that attention before bedtime, then they take away your time to sleep. So what I'm saying about Spencer, and I'm not trying to say he's a dog, but you probably need to give him an opportunity to do his bitch session way before bedtime. Do it way before bedtime. Do it maybe at dinner time. Hey, what happened today? Because, you know, when it's time for bed, I want to go straight to bed. And I know if you've had a rough day and you want to get some stuff off your chest, or if you had a great day and you want to tell me everything that's happened that is really great. Because I think what happens is when a puppy gets what they want, or when anybody gets what they want, over and over and over again, it just reinforces that bad behavior. So at some point, he must have recognized that he gets his best attention at night when you're in bed and you are full attention and listening. You're not distracted. You're not busy with other things. You're not watching a TV show. You give him your full attention, and he probably loves that, because that's what I do. I really love that attention from my husband. And if that's the only time that I can get it is when I'm in bed with him, then I'm going to eat that up and take advantage of it. But I didn't get his full attention every time. So it was really just frustrating more than anything. So anyways, okay.